Hello everyone, how are we doing today? So in this video, we're going to be going through a bunch of histology images and looking at examples of tissues throughout the body from various regions and organs and whatnot. So our focus here is to go through a bunch of images, most of them, except for one I took on the microscope. So they are my own. And we're going to go through and try to understand what we're looking at in these histology slides. One thing, it's hard to tell, and they can change from tissue sample to tissue sample based on your staining techniques and whatnot. So we're focused today on just giving a good general overview of all the tissue categories. So the first category are the epithelial tissues. These are the linings and coverings. The first example here that I have is simple squamous tissue. Remember, simple squamous is a single layer of flattened like cells. And we see this as an example in the lung alveolar, which are the air sacs in the lungs. It's just a simple flattened layer of cells. And so like capillaries here allows for adequate gas exchange to occur quickly. So you get oxygen into your blood and get the CO2 out of your blood. This also makes your lungs very delicate, and your lungs could easily collapse if it wasn't for the production of things like surfactant and whatnot to reduce the surface tension inside these alveoli. So this is the one image that I didn't take. The rest are all ones I took on classroom microscope slides. All right, next up is simple cuboidal. This is from the thyroid gland. So this is also, you know, what am I looking at here? So again, We haven't gone over the thyroid gland yet, but simple cuboidal, we're looking for a single layer of cube-like cells. And when we look at these structures in the thyroid, we're looking at these little follicles here. And within these, there are the little cubes that make up the walls of these are called follicular cells of the thyroid. And so they go all around. You can see some nuclei stained in there. So this would be, you know, two lined up. It's not stratified, it's two separate sections. And inside here in the thyroid, this is called the colloid, and this is actually where the thyroid hormones are assembled. You can see some little squares over here. So here, the thyroid gland is an example of simple cuboidal. Also some other sort of glands and whatnot have these cube-like cells around them. Next one, simple columnar. So here, this example is from uterine tubes, and uterine tubes or fallopian tubes are also ciliated. So here you see the nuclei all stained and lined up in the same direction. There could be some mucus-producing cells or goblet cells found in here as well, but these all form column-like cells, and it's in a single layer. And this little fuzziness on the outside, that is the cilia. So these are ciliated cells, and this is an image from the uterine tubes. Down here is connective tissue. So this would be the basement membrane and then the connective tissue down underneath. So when you're focused on this and what you're looking at, we're focused on this epithelial layer right here. There are other tissues that we see in these images, but we're just focused on the epithelial layer. Next one is stratified squamous. This one is an example of the esophagus, which is, you know, the food tube that goes to your stomach. Another example of stratified squamous would be epidermis of your skin. So here, this is connective tissue, that's the dermis, and above this is then the epidermis. So this is the separation, not epidermis, but the epithelial tissue here, stratified squamous. If we're talking about the skin, this is the dermis, and then this is the epidermis. But anyway, looking at the linings of this, we have cells down here that are dividing and working their way up. And as they work their way up, they flatten. So we have multiple layers, so stratified, and the apical layer of this is a squamous-like cell. So we have stratified squamous. So this is areas where there's a lot of abrasion happening. So as these dead cells leave, the upper layer cells on this are dead, new ones are grown from underneath and they push their way up. So it's a protective mechanism. Next type of epithelial tissue is from the trachea. This is pseudo-stratified columnar, or you could just say pseudo-stratified. Pseudo-stratified means false layers. So when we look at this tissue here, we're looking at this area right here is the epithelial tissue lining inside the trachea. One, we see cilia, so these are ciliated as well. And then here, it looks like there's a layer there, a layer there, a layer there. So it's like a false representation of layers. But really, these are a single layer of cube-like cells with some mucin or goblet cells interspersed in there as well. Over here, a single layer of column-like cells, I think I accidentally said cube. Over here would be a submucosal gland, and some of these could have cube-like cells, and so you can see how that could be a gland. So that would be simple cuboidal right there, but here is the pseudostratified columnar, and this one from the trachea is ciliated. The other parts here would be just connective tissue, and there could be some smooth muscle in there as well. Next, in the last epithelial tissue here, is transitional tissue. Now, this is hard to capture in a microscope image, but this is from the ureter. So as urine moves through, the volume pushes out on the walls of the ureter. So the layer we're focused on here is this layer right there. So this is the epithelial lining, and down here is connective tissue. So here we have, it looks stratified, and it can be, and then we have these different cells. So as volume pushes out, these cells get compressed and can become more squamous or cuboidal-like. So it transitions from one cell type into another. So bladder, ureter, urethra are all examples of where we find this sort of tissue. All right, so that's the epithelial tissues. Now we go into our connective tissues, beginning with connective tissue proper. So we have loose and dense, loose adipose, areolar, and then we have reticular, and then we have dense, regular, irregular, and elastic. So first up, we have loose adipose. This is from the hypodermis, which is a white fat layer deep to the dermis. And so here we see the oil droplets, get the little nuclei. These are called the adipocytes. And it looks like droplets of oil and water, and this is fat storage. So that's loose adipose. And then we have loose areolar. This image is from the papillary layer of the dermis. So when we have the skin, we have the epidermis as the upper layer. And then the dermis is beneath that. And the first layer of the dermis is the papillary layer. And then there's another layer below that, which is still within the dermis. So the dermis is broken up into two layers. So we have the papillary layer and the reticular layer. Reticular layer is one we're going to talk about later, which is dense irregular, but the papillary layer is this loose areolar. Loose areolar is the most abundant connective tissue. It's the one that's pretty much found everywhere. And this is just a mix of fibers. So pink here, we see collagen fibers. Blue would be elastic fibers. And so this is able to have a lot of ground substance, a lot of fluid storage in it. Fibrocytes are found in it. You got dendritic cells moving around in it. And so this is just a very loose area, but the elastic gives it stretch and things like that to it as well. So loose areolar, again, most abundant one, and this is just one example from the papillary layer of the dermis. And then we have loose reticular. Loose reticular is where we bring in these reticular fibers, which they're not differentially stained in this image, but we would have these reticular branch fibers coming out in this image. And lymph nodes, fluid moves through the lymph nodes, and as fluid moves through, it gets cleansed. So there are macrophages, B cells, and T cells that seed themselves on the reticular. T cells don't, but macrophages and B cells seed themselves on these reticular fiber scaffolds. So as the fluid, lymph fluid moves through it, if it needs to be processed, if there's any microorganisms, any immune system activations, anything like that, it can activate these cells and undergo proliferation. Another place these loose reticular fibers are found are in the spleen, where a similar sort of feature happens. And then we get dense regular. So now the dense fiber. So for dense regular, let me switch colors here to blue, we get a dense arrangement of collagen fibers running up through here. So you can see the little lines and tendons. So this is an example of a tendon. And tendons are usually teased when imaged, and it just helps pull these fibers out a little bit and separate them so you can get more light coming through for microscopy. So you might see them written as teased tendons. And then right here you see nuclei. So nuclei of these cells for, you know, the collagen producing cells in that. So these are our tendons, and this is where dense regular, they all run in that regular direction. And then we have dense irregular, where they all run in an irregular direction. So here all these fibers are running in different directions here, and this is the reticular layer of the dermis like I talked about earlier. And so here it resists pull from multiple directions. Your joint capsules around your synovial joints, like your shoulder, where you're twisting multiple ways, also has this sort of dense, irregular connective tissue. So remember, collagen is one of the stronger proteins in the body, has a very high tensile strength. So it all depends on how it lines up, though, and how it resists that tension. Last connective tissue proper here is dense elastic connective tissue. And the example here is from the wall of the aorta. So elastic means it has these elastic fibers in it, made of a protein called elastin. These dark fibers are what I'm talking about. So they line up in a regular pattern right here. And right here would be the inside of the aorta. And every heartbeat you have, so when we say 120 over 80, that's 120 millimeters of mercury pushing out on the wall of your aorta. And so it has to be very elastic and be able to stretch and recoil back to its optimal length or diameter. So this elastic tissue in those muscular arteries there is very important so that it has that recoil ability. Also makes a really cool histology image. I love the colors on this one. And then we get to more connective tissue, cartilage, blood, and bone. Three types of cartilage. First one here is hyaline cartilage. This example is from the trachea. So the cartilaginous rings in the trachea that hold your windpipe open. And remember, when looking at cartilage, you're looking for those lacunae in here, the pockets that hold those chondrocytes. So here the stain didn't wash out super well, but you can see some out here as well. And then you could have, these ones might be chondroblasts, which would be actively producing ground substance, collagen fibers. So this would be irregular arrangement of collagen fibers found within the cartilage, no vasculature. And then out here, this structure is known as the perichondrium, which it grows around the cartilage and where it gets its nutrients. So this is a really cool picture. Hyaline, most abundant cartilage, costal cartilage of your lungs, trachea, tip of your nose, ends of your long bones, and so forth. Next up is another cool one, elastic cartilage. Only found in two places. This image is from the epiglottis, but it's also found on in your ear for the pinnas of your ears. And here, it's like hyaline. You still have the pockets of chondrocytes, and you still have the collagen, but now you have these dark fibers. These dark fibers are elastic fibers, that protein elastin. And wherever you have these, it has more elasticity, more stretch, more recoil. So that's where these would be abundant. So epiglottis, flapping to cover the glottis, epiglottis, when swallowing food, so food doesn't go down your trachea. And then this isn't a great image here, but I still included it. This is fibrocartilage. So fibrocartilage is what we find in the intervertebral disc, so the disc in your back, meniscus in your knee, and pubic symphysis. And you can't, this didn't differentially stain the collagen fibers, but here the collagen fibers are lined up in the same, in a parallel direction here, not irregular, regular direction. You still have the chondrocytes and their pockets of the lacunae. And remember, fibrocartilage is important in resisting compression. Think of the pressure pushing down in between the vertebrae on your back. So this one is fibrocartilage. And then next up, we have blood. So blood, you're looking for little dots. Those are the platelets. The red blood cells here are anucleate, meaning they lack a nucleus. They don't look like donuts. It's just the biconcave shape of a red blood cell makes it so light goes through the middle of the red blood cell a lot easier than the edges. So some of these might look like donuts. Trust me, they are not. And then we see some white blood cells in here as well. So they're larger and they have nuclei, these bilobed and larger nuclei that stain. So this would be blood, and blood is considered a connective tissue. There is a soluble fiber component in it, with the ground substance being the plasma and fluids moving in your blood. And then we have bone. Bone is also known as your osseous tissue. This example here is compact bone. Super, super cool. Bone has a central canal and then the rings, lamellae that go around the bone rings here. And then you have the osteocytes housed in these little dark pockets. They all connect to each other via structures called canaliculi. And so all these little tree trunk-like things line up and give bone its strength. This will be talked about more when we get to the bone chapters. But another cool image here for bone. Again, this is for compact bone. There's also spongy bone as well. And then we get to our three types of muscles and then nervous tissue. So a lot of fun images here we're going through. And I think histology is great. I hope you're enjoying it too. All right, now skeletal tissue. Skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, and smooth muscle. What are the differences? Well, skeletal muscle, we see striations. This is the overlapping of the thick and the thin filament. So you see this little striping pattern there. It's multinucleate, so these muscle fibers have multiple nuclei in them. Also, skeletal muscle, you can't see it in image, but skeletal muscle is also voluntary. So we see that here. We see the striations and we see all these nuclei. Cardiac then is involuntary. Again, you can't see that. And these cells have only one nucleus. So here, these would be just one single nucleus, and they are shorter cells. You can't, see all the cells here, but they are shorter cells, whereas skeletal muscle cells can be very, very long. Another significant thing here in what you want to look for, I know this one's stained blue because this one's trying to specifically highlight these little dark lines, which are called the interculated discs. These are the gap junctions that allow cardiac cells to communicate instantaneously with each other and allows your heart to beat as a unit. So this one's just staining the nuclei and those interculated discs. So seeing the actual cell structures. Also, cardiac cells are striated. And if you look closely here, you can see those striation patterns on this cardiac muscle as well. Smooth muscle then is also involuntary, but it is not striated. So it lacks striations and they are just one single nucleus. Now here, not perfectly stained, it's just pretty much pink image, but you can see nuclei. And so the cells would be smaller cells found in here then with the stained nuclei. You can see some of them. So they line up more as sheets. And here you can see the sheets kind of lining up this direction. So this could be like a longitudinal sheet of smooth muscle. You can also have circular sheets of smooth muscles, and that allows for like the peristaltic wave to occur. I don't recall where this smooth muscle image was taken from, but there are lots of areas where we find smooth muscles. Pretty much all the walls of the hollow organs except the heart has some sort of smooth muscle amount in them. All your arteries, your digestive system, and so forth. And then last one here is your nervous tissue. Now this doesn't include all the associated cells, but here this image is just showing a neuron. So a neuron has the nucleus and the cell body around it with all the different dendritic endings coming in where all the sensory input is coming in. And then at some point has a long axon that then goes out and sends that signal down to the secretory region. Up here you can faintly see the outline of another cell body and so forth. And so these are neurons. Over here you might be able to slightly see an axon which might have some degree of myelination on it. Again, we're not going over all the little intricacies of the structure of a neuron, but nervous tissue is a tissue as well. It includes the neurons and associated glial cells that go along with it. Alrighty, that is our little histology lab here. So we went over a lot of tissues today, and I hope this helps you get this histology stuff down and being able to look at these histology images a little better, because it's not like looking at a textbook artistic representation. These are actual images from the source, and they all depend on how you stain them and so forth. But that's all I have for today. If you have questions on this stuff, be sure to let me know. But if not, have a great rest of your day, and bye-bye.